Put on your big Hollywood sunglasses and light the torch, because it's cellar time. Welcome to the Crack Cellar. As the prophecy was foretold, I'm Two Spirit Penguin Daniel.
And I am the bourbon.
Well, we're going to need a lot of liquor because Alien and Predator have both been acquired by Marvel, aka Disney. Broadcaster Nickels, on a scale of 1 to 10, how excited are you for G-rated facehuggers?
Well, I've actually been surprised time and time again how much Disney owns. And I was kind of surprised they didn't already own this. So that's where I'm sitting.
Oh, man. As soon as I heard the news, the first thing I thought of was Spaceballs. You remember in Spaceballs at the end of the movie, after like the whole thing went down, Barf and Lone Star were at like a little diner. And the dude gets sick, who also I think... That guy was in Alien, too. I think the guy in Spaceballs that gets sick, I think it was a cameo or something, but I could be wrong about that, but I think it was. Anyway, this guy, all of a sudden he's like, I don't feel good, and a fucking alien pops out of his chest. You know, an homage to the original Alien. It just starts singing a show tune, like, hello, my baby, hello, my sonny. I just, like, see that baby xenomorph doing show tunes. I'm like, well, this is actually what Alien's gonna be under Disney. Like, this is
it. Yeah, I just can't wait to see how they neuter those scenes in the movie. They're probably gonna be super quick. It's probably not even gonna show the thing on the facehugger on the face anymore. You're probably not gonna see any struggle or any strangulation.
Yeah,
it's kind of weird. Who knows? Disney's acquiring a lot of IP that not only is R-rated, but has a cult following. The only reason it is successful is that is for those cults, you know. So I don't think they're gonna be able to get away with changing all these IPs like Deadpool and Alien and Predator. It just seems like if they've turned the tables on those franchises, it's like, what do you have? I think they're going to do like a DC Black Label type thing, you know, like with what DC did with Joker. I can see them doing something like that.
Interesting. I don't think Disney has the balls to do something like that.
Well, times are changing.
I could be, they're changing, not for the more balls. We're getting less balls, all right?
Well, not, but, you know, just the fact that these Hollywood's going to be struggling pretty bad here. I don't think they can afford to be throwing away any movies, you know?
Yeah, it's really interesting, this whole lockdown. Hollywood's been shut down now for 5 months. That's crazy. Yeah, like 5 or 6 months. Hollywood has been shut down. This is unprecedented. There's never been a period like that where it's been shut down like that. So we're going to see some really weird fallout from that. I wonder if they're going to like go get like old movies that they shelved that they're like, this isn't good enough. And they're like, well, fuck it. We need something to release at this time. So we're going to release this bullshit now. I wonder if we're going to see some real schlock.
Well, have you seen that new Steve Carell movie yet?
Oh, God. Irresistible? Is that what you're saying? I haven't watched that yet, but I saw like a little bit
that
of like
supposedly a clip. Was going to hit the big screen. I don't believe it.
Yeah.
There's a good example of them whipping out the schlock.
Yeah. Steve Carell, man, it's weird. He was such a good comedic actor a long time ago. The last 7 or 8 years now, everything he does just sucks. He's not in anything really good. He's not funny anymore.
I think a lot of people like that, when they bow out of the game for so long, it's kind of hard to come back. Very few people do that shit.
I'll bet you anything, if Rick Moranis came out of retirement, he'd throw the hammer down instantly.
Rick Moranis. World doesn't deserve that, man.
No. But yeah, going back to Alien and Predator, going back to Deadpool, let's start there. I've seen quotes from the creator of the Deadpool movies where he has basically said Deadpool is dead in the water.
Yeah.
So to me, that is the first bullet in the war against the R-rated movies that they acquired in that whole acquisition. So if Deadpool is dead in the water, I cannot imagine a legitimate Alien or Predator movie coming from this outfit. I can't imagine it.
Yeah, time will only tell, you know. I don't think Disney will be able, like I said earlier, they'll be able to throw away potential money and risk. And on the other side of that coin is risk money as well. When they acquire these franchises, especially now more than ever, they got to kind of stay true to what the IPs are to at least make some money. Now is not the time to be making huge risks where it's like, let's acquire the Alien and Predator franchise and make it all, you know, no one's going to bleed, no guts, no violence, whatever the fuck they want to add. Let's add diversity or whatever. Let's make Ripley black or trans or whatever.
Oh, fuck. You know, don't whatever you the dare, fuck it Disney. Is, right? Don't you dare.
I just don't think they really have the room, the liberty for that type of shit in cult-following franchises like Alien and Predator.
They'll face serious already backlash.
There's little room for backlash. Like, these movies barely make money when they're successful.
Mm-hmm.
Time is told that some of these movies, that's like a 50-50 if some of those movies just flop, you know? So, yeah.
What I'm curious about is there was supposed to be a final Prometheus movie coming out that Scott Ridley was working on. So what's happening then? Is he still going to be able to make this, or is Disney going to stomp it out of existence? Because I don't know about you, I really liked the new Prometheus movies. I liked both of them. And I know some people, you know, don't like them, and that's their opinion. Everyone has their own opinion. But as someone that has consumed an ungodly amount of science fiction, I really, for my money, man, there were some really cool elements to those Prometheus movies, especially the way they do Elizabeth Shaw in Covenant. That was some dark, dark shit, and I really appreciated it.
Yeah, it was also new for the Alien universe as well. Like, anybody that's like a real fan of the Alien universe will know that the franchise needed rejuvenation, and I think Prometheus did it. They, instead of like rebooting the universe, they just shifted focus on another aspect of the universe that was never told.
Yep.
And yeah. Some people just think it was lame, you know, that you didn't see enough of the Prometheans, or you know, the Prometheans were lame themselves, or the engineers, whatever you want to call them.
Yeah. Well, I think that the original Prometheus movie was kind of a nod to the original Alien movie, because a lot of people forget.
It totally was.
That the original Alien movie was a slow-burning horror movie set in space. Aliens, totally different. It was a fucking action movie. It might as well have been Starship Troopers. Like, it was totally, and I love both movies, don't get me wrong, but like, the original Alien, it has a lot in common with Prometheus, a lot more than the detractors and haters would like you to believe.
Yeah, for sure. I'm a huge fan of Covenant and Prometheus, but I thought Covenant was the one where they really kicked it up to 11. I was really impressed with where they took the franchise as a whole and where they promised to take it going forward. And I'm going to be really bummed if you don't get to see the culmination of that in the third movie.
For sure. Yeah, I definitely like... Who is
the other one? The good one that appeared in Covenant. I always forget. Walter? Yeah, it was Walter.
Yeah. Yeah, I like Prometheus a lot, but Covenant was way better. Covenant is one of the better sci-fi movies to come out in the last 10 years, in my opinion. It's up there. Like, it's not the best, but it's really good. It had... Everything about it was really good. They didn't tone anything down. It was very unique and opaque, and it played out to its horror roots, but also added a little bit more sci-fi tinge to it while upping the brutality at the same time. Like when they dropped that gas down onto the fucking, towards the end of the movie to transform, that was some brutal shit, man. Like there were some parts of that movie where I was just like, damn.
Yeah. Well, it was cool. Like, I mean, that was the type of stuff. I mean, that's not really what cosmic horror is, but Prometheus and Covenant really tried to do that.
Yeah.
They were like trying to tie the cosmic horror aspect to what a xenomorph is, like where did it come. Essentially, what I'm trying to say is they were trying to paint the origins of xenomorphs as kind of like a very cosmic horror type of origin.
Yeah.
You know?
Totally. That's a good point. Yeah. There's,
you run into an ancient civilization that has a substance that's pretty much uncontrollable. An ungodly creation was created from it and plagues the universe going forth.
Yeah. No, now that you mention it, there is a Lovecraft story that has a crap load in common with Alien Covenant.
For sure.
I don't want to say which one, but in case you ever read it someday. But fucking A, dude, you're right about that. That's on the nose. There's a lot of Lovecraft influence in the Prometheus movies. But I think the biggest surprise of those movies, well, I think it was in Covenant. It was Danny McBride not being Eastbound and Down. Like, I when I went into that and I heard he was in it, I was like, fuck, no, you're gonna ruin it. I'm going to see him as Kenny Powers. This is not good. He fucking nailed it, man. I was super impressed with McBride.
Yeah. And spoiler alert, because it's been long enough.
Yeah.
I thought it was pretty fucking cool how they set him up to be the first alpha.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. But yeah. So, well, I mean, I guess my hope with all this is that they leave alone the Prometheus, this third Prometheus movie. They let him finish it. Finish the trilogy, and then do your dark shit that you want to, the abomination you want to turn this shit into, do it after we finish this trilogy. Please, Disney, for the love of God.
I don't know what they could do. I just don't know what Disney is doing or trying to acquire that IP. It's just not, what interest do they have?
Hopefully they just up and resell it. That'd be the best case scenario, but knowing these guys, I don't see that happening.
Yeah, true.
It is a bummer. As far as the Predator side goes, Predator has just been in such a bad place for so long. I'm not even worried. Really? You like the new Predator movies a lot?
I like Predators with Adrian Brody. That was dope. And Lawrence Fishburne. That was pretty dope. They had what's his name? Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Or not Spider-Man. It was the guy from That 70s Show. What's his name? as the psychopath.
Yeah.
Oh, that movie was dope.
When did that movie come out? It was a long time ago, right?
Years ago. Yeah.
Wasn't that like in the 2000s? It was around Alien versus Predator, right? Like a little after it.
Yeah, I'll be honest. I remember I was drunk when I went to go see it.
Yeah.
So,
well, I think that theater, movie is about so I had 10.
At least 9 years.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I was thinking. So you're right. That one was pretty good, but I was more thinking like the ones in the last 10 years. That's a little. I mean, I like that newest Predator movie for about 15 minutes of the total movie, but Jesus Christ, there is some really bad shit in that.
That one was pretty bad.
Yeah,
it's who was in that?
Dude,
I remember now being like enraged by Olivia Munn.
Yes.
That's who it was. She could run faster than the Predators. Oh, that blew my mind. I was boggled by it. I remember being pissed drunk and just being like, wait a minute, this doesn't add up and I'm drunk.
Yeah. It was offensive. It was almost like Olivia Munn had like really bad evidence on whoever was making this movie. Like like I'm talking like prison evidence. And she's like, listen, you're going to make me into fucking Ellen Ripley, and she doesn't deserve to be Ellen Ripley, and definitely not more powerful than Ellen Ripley, which is the way they described her in this movie. Like, she was a superhero. It was offensive, like you said. That's a great way to put it. Offensive.
She runs like fucking 40 miles per hour on this like bridge and like then a gazelle. Jumps onto a fucking jet engine ship, and she like somehow like grips on. I forget how the scene goes. Then gets thrown off of it on the ground. She must be hurling at least, I don't know, at least 60 miles per hour. Let's be real. She was going pretty damn fast, and maybe a little less. And she's chill. She just gets up, fights a good fight, wins. That's unbelievable.
Yeah,
and she's more frail than ever. If it was like maybe IGN, if it was, you know, like Tech TV or G4, that Olivia Munn,
yeah,
maybe she could handle it, but not in 2020.
Yeah, the circa Chun Li Olivia Munn. Yes, she was a little bit in better shape back then. I mean, she's in good shape in that movie too, but she had some muscles back then. I think she actually did weight training back in those days.
I also don't think she did as many drugs. Ooh.
Moving on. Broadcaster Nickels. Michael Keaton is back as Batman 30 years later. Is this not like the greatest news you've heard in at least 5 minutes?
Yes. And the only thing else that could make it better is hearing Jack Nicholson reprise his role as the Joker.
Oh, we don't deserve that.
We don't. We really don't. And I also don't. I mean, I'd love to think Jack Nicholson is up for it, but I just get the impression he's probably not.
Hmm.
And a word on the street is that the fanboys are finally getting what they want. And Michael Keaton's Batman is going to be the Batman that grows old and ushers in Terry from Batman Beyond.
Yeah. I know when we first talked about this, it wasn't like confirmed, I think. And we were just kind of speculating that it might be Batman Beyond, but I think they actually confirmed it since then. Right. Did you read that?
I don't know if it's confirmed, but like, I think it's coming from a credible source. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't try to pay attention too much to it.
I definitely saw some strong evidence lately that it is going to be a Batman Beyond storyline, and that's pretty good. I really like Batman Beyond. I know you really like Batman Beyond, and the thought of Michael Keaton coming full circle and playing old man, the old Batman, it just, could DC be nailing it any harder than they have for the last couple years? Like, I swear to God, DC is just shitting gold right now.
I think it's hired the right person finally.
Yeah.
It clearly seems like they have a person with a vision. I think what happened was somebody saw Joker and they wanted to work for DC. Someone that actually has a fucking idea.
Mm-hmm.
Someone tells me they picked up talent right around then. Because it seems like they just turned the ship around.
For sure.
Now, the only thing I can see them going bad is with their sequels to all their past DC movies like Aquaman 2 and Shazam 2 and Wonder Woman 1984 or whatever it is. I mean, those all have the potential to be good, but then again, they all have the potential just to be meh and not help the hype train.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen all those movies. I've actually seen every DC movie that's come out, I think, in like the last 8 years or so. I think, I'm pretty sure, even the bad ones. Like, I was there for, you know, obviously the Whedon cut of Justice League, which was, God, I'm not even going to talk. We're just going to skip right past that. You know, the OG Superman reboot with Cavill and, you know, Batman v Superman, all these movies and all these recent ones like Aquaman and Shazam. And honestly, I still
think Man of Steel is my favorite.
Dude, I fucking love Man of Steel. And people talk shit about it all the time, but those people can go to hell. I fucking loved Zod. I loved Superman.
Michael Shannon is Zod, dude. Oh, that was fucking crisp.
Pennies from heaven, man. That was just perfect. And I like those movies. I thought that they were going down a dark path with this whole Whedon Justice League because they were trying to imitate Marvel right as Marvel was going downhill. it was really bad strategy. And I think that they came out the other side realizing that, and they've just flipped. Because as we've mentioned, everything recently with them, it's just been good news, good news, good news. We get the Snyder Cut now, so we get to see if Justice League really was all ruined by Whedon, or if it was just a bad movie, period. I'm very interested to see how that turns out. I personally thought Aquaman was really cool. Aquaman kind of reminded me of Star Wars Episode 1, with, like, the whole Gungan arc and going underwater, like, there's always a bigger fish, you know what I mean? That whole part of the Episode 1. A lot of the graphics and a lot of the effects, it was just very reminiscent of that. And maybe it's a nostalgia thing, but I really liked Aquaman because of that. And Shazam, clearly a kid's movie, but I mean, a really good one. If I saw Shazam when I was 12, I would have fucking loved that movie.
I still haven't seen that movie.
It's not like a must watch or anything, but it's a good movie. And as an adult, it's a good movie. As a kid, I think it's a fucking amazing movie. Just, you know, I can't really say for sure, but just knowing myself at that age, the age which that movie was designed for, I feel like for kids that age, it had to have been just a fucking knockout of the park.
I think it was. I'm pretty sure that's where all the success came from for that movie. So,
yeah. Yeah, so yeah, Michael Keaton, where does he rank on your all-time Batman list? Because we have the Crack Cellar official Joker rating system, which we have already established, a very clear hierarchy that you 100% agree with, but we have never gone over the Batman hierarchy. Is Keaton your S rank, or is there someone higher?
I mean, I probably would put... I probably would put Keaton at the top just because he's so classic and he did it so well. Yep. But I don't know. Christian Bale's his performance of Batman really defined the modern Batman, and it's still coming through to this day, you know. So I think he deserves an honorable mention.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, I would probably him as my A rank. Either him or George Clooney, obviously.
Shut the fuck up. Bat nipples? Are you kidding me,
dude? If we just hypothetically switch to the Batman ranking system, we would have to create a new rank for George Clooney. We would have to go well beyond the D.
That would be special mission.
He was so bad. He was like, I've never seen an actor so uninterested in being in a movie as George Clooney in Batman and Robin. Like, it was just so... Dude, Arnold Schwarzenegger's Mr. Freeze wanted to be in that movie more than Clooney.
Totally. Well, I think Arnold actually was... could tell he was feeling it. He was totally feeling it.
Yeah, I loved all his corny one-liners. Are you kidding me?
I get to play in Batman?
He's like,
what's in my line? Off. Yeah. Prepare to freeze.
Oh, here, shit.
Take these. Give them to Alfred. They'll cool his blood. Kill his disease.
God. Someday scientists are going to study that movie. But until that time, what do you think is the future of Michael Keaton in the DC universe? So we know he's back in at least a one-off movie role. Do you think there's a possibility this could stretch out? Do you think he could be in multiple movies? Do you think Absolutely. He could actually be in a real Batman movie again? Like, I know we have Robert Pattinson coming as the next Batman, which is going to be like the Batman for the Joaquin Phoenix Joker. Like, they're going to be in the same timeline or whatever.
We don't know that yet.
Really?
Have they confirmed that he's DC Black Label? Is Batman's?
I was under the impression that that was confirmed, but now that you say it, I'm starting to question it. So maybe it's just like the Batman Beyond thing. Strong suspicion, maybe not confirmed.
Yeah, I mean, back to that guy in the room that has a vision. If there is somebody that truly is there, they might be setting some, you know, Crisis on Infinite Earth shit up, you know, where Black Label is going to be this totally separate universe for a while, where they build up that narrative, and then they have the regular universe with Shazam and Aquaman and the Justice League, and and all that stuff, which is kind of like the more kid-friendly universe.
Yeah.
And every once in a while, they might do a crossover. They might have like an ultimate event kind of thing, because it lines up with some pretty popular comic events. But, you know, that being said, it comes off like, what's his name? What's his name?
Robert Pattinson.
Robert Pattinson. His Batman seems more like a year one Batman.
Yeah.
You know? So I don't know if that's necessarily going to put him in with the Joker with DC Black Label, which seems to be pretty violent.
Well, like, the ages don't make sense either, because you meet Bruce Wayne in Joker and he's like, what, 10 or something like that? Yeah, so
they know when year one starts.
Right. So if they did combine those two and make them each other's Batman and Joker, Joaquin Phoenix would have to be like digitally aged for it to make sense, unless they go against their own canon they just established.
Well, it also doesn't have to be Joaquin Phoenix. I mean,
well, maybe it won't be, but that's the rumor I heard, is that they're going to be connected.
It looks like, I mean, they might use Joaquin Phoenix's one-time performance to start the movement, to start the real Joker. Like the product, real Joker might be a product, a birth child of like the movement Joaquin Phoenix's Joker started, you know?
So you think that Joaquin Phoenix might be Jerome and not Joker? Is that kind of where you're going?
Who's Jerome?
Jerome was like the inspiration for the real Joker in one of the comics. I forget which one, but it's basically what you just said.
Yeah. Yeah, something like that. It's just, it just doesn't seem like they could combine those two movies at all. Because I watched Joker recently, and that just seems like such a one-off movie. Can't imagine
it's an art piece.
Any of the other DC content to that movie.
Well, it also sets Batman, this new Batman, up with some really high starting expectations, which, you know, it's kind of unfair, because Joker is like a once in a generation type movie. And you're going to say, I hope you're ready, Robert Pattinson, because this is what you're aiming for. And if it's anything less, you're fired.
I got more and more hype for Robert Pattinson of late, because he just like came out of nowhere and just started doing a bunch of movies, which makes me think, you know, like, he's down for it, you know?
Yeah.
Because he was originally, when he started acting like in Twilight Show, which I still haven't seen to this day, but
I only saw the first one, and it haunts me to this day. I still like relive some of the scenes in my nightmares every once in a while.
I saw him in Harry Potter where he got ghosted. That was pretty funny. But he disappeared for a long time, and then he came back and he did The Lighthouse.
I think he got into drugs.
Something.
Yeah.
But now he's in Tenet. He's doing Batman. He was in The Lighthouse.
Wait a second.
I don't know.
Is Tenet a prequel to this new Batman movie? Is that what's going on here? Like the beginning.
Cue Hans Zimmerman music.
At the beginning of Tenet, like in the pre-intro. It's like a movie by Christopher Nolan. And then a fade, and it's like in association with DC Comics, and the whole theater explodes. Maybe not. Anyway, do you think there's a possibility we're going to see Robin anytime soon in DC? Because we haven't seen Robin in any movies since the aforementioned Batman and Robin with George Clooney.
Listen, I think we need to talk about why Robin hasn't showed up in a long time. And I think that has a lot to do with the archetype of the character.
Yeah.
He's just kind of, how can I put this PC, kind of gay. All right. Like, and not like, you know, fabulous type gay. I mean, like, no. Gay, like lame gay. You know, like.
Totally. Yeah, if like if one of your like if you were in fifth grade and you're talking about Batman and one of your friends was like, "I like Robin more than Batman," you would like give that guy
he deserves swirly. To be punched.
Yeah, you take him to the bathroom and dunk his head into the toilet and flush. You know, so
his parents probably don't love him.
No, probably not. But I just wonder because it's been so long and you could just see like some executive in the studio be like, "Hey, we haven't rolled out Robin in a while. That'd be fresh, right?"
I mean, they would have to like totally rethink his character, which mm-hmm. would be hard because then it wouldn't line up with what I think they should do, to be honest, is when if they ever do come up to the point where they can bring in Robin or someone of that lineage, they should just skip right over young Robin and bring in like Nightwing or the Red Hood or who's the other one? Red Robin.
Yeah.
Those are all three of the Robins all grown up essentially. Like if they bring in one of those guys and just kind of skip over and they're like, "Yeah, remember when I used to hang out with your mansion and my parents didn't care? Oh wait, they were dead." And they laugh and it's a joke, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, they could do one of those.
out of those, I think Nightwing is probably the one I'd see happening.
I'd like to see Red Hood.
I would like to see Red Hood, but I feel like my heart says Red Hood, but my brain says Nightwing.
Yeah. Dick Grayson, is it? Yeah. Todd is Red Hood. And then Dick Grayson is Nightwing.
Yeah.
I forget who Red Robin is.
I don't even know Red Robin. That's one that I never read any comics for.
I'm pretty sure he's the original Robin. He's like the OG Robin.
Ah. Well.
He's the one from the trap who his parents died in the circus accident. He's that Robin.
Speaking of circus accidents, Broadcaster Nickels, are you ready for our preview of Bill and Ted Face the Music?
Excellent.
What's that? You want more Crack Cellar? This is good. Join your lords on Twitter at the Crack Cellar. And facebook.com/thecrackseller.
Hey, you over there. Are you a straight-up Chad or a strong woman? Well, you can find us on Apple Podcasts and your favorite podcasting app. Or, if you're a straight-up beta cuck, find us on YouTube with the rest of the Cloud Chasers.
And we're back with our preview of Bill and Ted Face the Music. Broadcaster Nickels, it is on a solemn note that we bid farewell to George Carlin, as he will not be able to reprise his role in this third Bill and Ted movie, which is really fucking sad, because Bill and Ted is what introduced me to George Carlin. I had no idea who George Carlin was. I saw him in Bill and Ted. And then I randomly saw him on HBO one time as a kid. I'm like, whoa, what's the dude from Bill and Ted doing on a stage talking to people? And I proceeded to watch whichever special that was. I think it was the one that was in New York, but I forget which exactly. And it literally changed my entire basis of comedy and what comedy was. And he became my favorite comedian, basically, I don't know if I still have him as my favorite of all time. Chappelle is up there too. There's a few that have kind of come close to him, but he is one of the titans, and he will be sorely missed in Bill and Ted Face the Music.
Most definitely. He is truly a titan of comedy. I remember the first time I ever heard him do the words you can't say.
Mm-hmm.
Is that him?
Yes, it was.
Carlin?
That was.
Yeah, the seven words you can't say. And I was like, holy shit.
Yeah.
You just warped my fragile little mind.
I think
he was actually one of the few people that ever taught me that it's just like, that words are just words, you know?
Yep.
And that it's really the intent behind them. That's the most important thing.
Exactly. Yeah.
But yes, rest in peace, Rufus. You will be missed.
Well, the good news is, based on the trailer, it looks like the Grim Reaper's back, who's played by the guy who did Sloan from Star Trek Deep Space Nine. And I'm glad about that because I really liked the Grim Reaper in Bogus Journey. He was, as a kid, he was probably my favorite character in the movie, other than Bill and Ted themselves.
I actually saw Bogus Journey first.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's crazy. Well,
that one was in 91, so.
It makes sense. Like, yeah, like that one was at least made when you were alive. So I totally get that, but it's weird to think about watching that one first and going back to Excellent Adventure, because they're very different movies. They're both comedies, but the writing style and the direction were way different between the two.
Yeah, I mean, the first one was more, it was quite literal, he was trying to write a history report. So he's like going through like periods of time and talking to, Galileo and I forget all the other fucking people he talked to. But
my favorite was Napoleon.
Yeah, all these historical figures. Yeah. Whereas Bill and Ted Bogus Journey, if I remember correctly, dealt with a lot more with like life and death.
It was metal, dude. It was like metal. It was like heavy metal Bill and Ted. Like
it was like heavy metal Bill and Ted.
Like some like space Nazis come after Bill and Ted with robot Bill and Teds. The robot Bill and Teds fucking murder the real Bill and Ted, send them to the afterlife. They meet the Grim Reaper, then they get sent down to hell, and they meet Satan himself. Like, there's just some
That's how they get out, is with the Battle of the Bands. That's how they regain their lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's crazy how different they were. I describe the first movie as sort of like Dude, Where's My Car? Mixed with Back to the Future. It's just like this weird little hodgepodge of like we're straight. This is a very straightforward movie where we're traveling through time, going through specific scenarios. But we have these two dudes that are like, whoa, dude, just like acting like tards the whole time. It's a very specific formula on the first one. And the second one gets a little bit more, like we said, a little more broad, a little bit more heaven and hell, life and death. The writing, the jokes were way funnier in the second one. I don't know if you agree with me on that or not, but personally, I thought Bogus Journey was way funnier than Excellent Adventure.
I mean, it's hard. Some really good moments in Excellent Adventure, but Bogus Journey is pretty good to me.
There is. Yeah. Bogus Journey had some really off color humor too. I don't. When was the last time you saw Bogus Journey?
It's been a long time since I've seen either of them.
Yeah,
probably since I was a teenager.
I rewatched both of them when they first came out on Blu-ray, so I think that was like 10 years ago or something like that. Maybe 8 years ago.
But it might be longer for me.
I remember when I watched Bogus Journey, and this was before like the woke-a-thon that exists now. Like this is back in like 2011, probably. It had some shit where I'm like, ooh, you wouldn't be able to do that today. Like, I remember very distinctly when the robot Bill and Ted is killing the real Bill and Ted. They're dangling them from a cliff. And I remember they were like begging for their lives, the real Bill and Ted. And then the evil robot Bill and Ted looks at each other and then laughs and then calls them fags as they drop them off the cliff and murders them. Like, that is pretty not acceptable for 2020.
I can't believe they even allowed it then.
I know. It's
pretty blunt.
it was. I mean, and it goes to show you, too, because like a lot of people our age are vilified for using the term fag. And when we were growing up, it was just an accepted word you used to describe something that was like girly and lame. It was just accepted. That's what you did. And that this movie proves it. Bogus Journey essentially proves it. It's like our fucking alibi. Like, hey, this is what we were raised on, dude. Keanu Reeves was calling people. Dude, Keanu Reeves in Bogus Journey literally calls Satan a fag. There's a part I remember when. Remember when they get put in down in like that labyrinth where they have to like relive their horrible childhood memories? Remember that part? Dude, there was a part where I remember Keanu was like running.
I remember them using the F-bomb. Oh,
dude,
they did.
Keanu was like running away from Satan, or he like talked shit to Satan, and then like I don't know. I just remember distinctly that Keanu called Satan a fag, and then Satan like fucking like force punched him through the corridor. And imagine hearing Keanu Reeves say something like that in 2020. It's unthinkable.
Fuck no. They wouldn't. There's no fucking way they'd even get close to making fun of homosexuality, even in the lightest terms.
No.
And you'd be hung.
And it makes me wonder, man, like, so is this going to be a situation like Beavis and Butthead, like South Park, like Always Sunny in Philadelphia, where they're kind of grandfathered in and people will just be like, ah, that's old stuff. Let the old people do the old stuff and let's move on. Do you think they're going to get that protection? Because I don't think they will. I think that if this movie comes out with bogus Journey level humor, they're going to try and cancel Keanu. I think it's going to happen, man.
I mean, I think if it's a good movie, they'll find a way to be edgy.
Yeah.
And, you know, that gets around everything.
Well, you can't get around everything. Now, I agree that they don't have to go around calling Satan a fag for it to be a good, funny movie. They don't have to do that.
Glad you stated that for the record.
But that being said, there does need to be that style, that edge in it. Otherwise, what's the point? Like, it'd be like if Cartman was doing Bart Simpson humor instead of Cartman humor. It's like, well, then what the fuck's the point of South Park then? You know what I'm saying? Like, I just wonder, because this trailer that we've watched, it looks like it combines elements of Excellent Adventure and Bogus Journey and kind of amalgamates them into one third movie that's a mix of the two. Did you get that impression?
Kind of. I think it deals with something to do with like how the future was changed in Bogus Journey.
Mm-hmm. Oh, for sure.
I think that has something to do with it, with this utopian society that they kind of like show in the trailer.
Well, yeah, because the utopian society they show in the trailer was actually shown at the beginning of Bogus Journey too. Remember that? Where they were all wearing like the really 80s looking like futuristic clothes when the bad guy first comes. That's the same place, right? Like just upgraded with new graphics.
I couldn't tell you. That's what my mind went to immediately. I will say that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, but it also, I think they might be trying to do like some weird Jay and Silent Bob type shit, you know, where they're bringing their kids in because. They're going to have daughters in this movie.
But, well, okay, and, but the, with, the, well, let's be fair. Jay and Silent Bob, they brought their real daughter in. And that was really cringy. Keanu Reeves doesn't have a daughter. So, like, whoever his daughter is in this movie isn't going to be his real life daughter. I'm okay with that. Like, God, why did you have to bring up that movie? I'd almost forgotten it, Broadcaster Nickels.
You know, also, though, I will bring up, is Keanu Reeves without his beard really shows how much he's aged. He hid it all behind that beard. I was like, man, Keanu Reeves is so youthful for his age. And then he shaved that beard off. I'm like, okay.
I don't think that a beard has helped any actor more than it has helped Keanu Reeves. Because if just imagine you just erase that beard from existence. Do you think he would have done as well in the last 20 years without that beard, looking the way he does without it?
No.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not trying to diss Keanu. I love Keanu Reeves. He's one of my favorite actors of all time, but it was crazy to see what his face looks like because he's worn that beard for like what? Like literally since 2006, right? It's 14 years, right?
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah, so like he just aged 14 years undercover, and we didn't get to see what was happening. And he shaves that beard charming. Off. Hoo-hoo.
It was like Kakashi removing his mask for the first time, to be honest. I was like, whoa.
It's a good reference. I like that.
Spoiler alert, you never see that.
What do you think? Will the soundtrack be as metal as Bogus Journey? Because I don't know if you remember this about Bogus Journey.
I hope it is.
That I said it. The original Bill and Ted Excellent Adventure introduced me to George Carlin. Bogus Journey introduced me to Megadeth. Are Fuck we yeah. going to have Dave Mustaine back in Bill and Ted Face the Music?
That dude, I would shed a tear because that guy's actually gone through a hell of a time. He just beat cancer recently.
Really?
That'd be cool to see him in this movie actually reappear.
That'd be awesome. I just hope they stick to the Bogus Journey soundtrack in general, because it wasn't just Megadeth. I remember it had a bunch of like badass old school heavy metal.
And, oh, dude. And hair metal.
Well, that's what old school heavy metal was, right? It was hair metal. Yeah. Yeah. I'm totally down for them to stick to that. Let's get a full hair metal soundtrack. Fucking have Dave Mustaine actually in the movie. It would be sick.
That would be too... That'd be too sick. I'm not gonna happen.
Yeah, probably not.
As Carl would from Aqua Teen would put it, it's too wicked.
But to me, this trailer looks like it paints this movie as a sequel to Bogus Journey. It just the impression I get, and you know, you can do trickery in trailers. Just watch the Tenet trailers, and that's all. Enough said. You can do trickery in trailers, but
stand down, soldier.
In this trailer, it really strikes me as like this is a direct sequel to Bogus Journey. It does not seem like a reboot or a remake or a spinoff.
No, I didn't get that impression at all. And I think they've been pretty clear about that too. Now, I might be making it up, but I swear in interviews, they've been pretty clear about it being a sequel.
I haven't seen a whole lot of I haven't seen a whole lot of interviews with them, so I may have missed that. I hope that that's true though, because I really get sick of like the pseudo reboot, pseudo sequel. We're not sure what we are, and we end up being nothing. I really like it when you stick to your guns, and it seems like that's what they're doing here.
For sure.
And both actors also. Were you kind of amazed at how easily they slid back into those characters after not doing them for 30 years? Like,
well, I think those guys are just really good friends.
I do too. Easy. Yeah.
It's easy for them to do it.
Yeah. When they're interacting with each other, like in the limited time in this trailer, you see them talking to each other. It's like going in a time machine, dude. Like they talk the exact same way. It's the exact opposite of CBS All Access's Star Trek Picard, in which Patrick Stewart literally forgot who Jean-Luc Picard was.
I think that's what that was the real smile on Riker's face the whole time. It wasn't acting. He was just smiling the whole time. He's just like, this motherfucker doesn't know where he's at right now.
Oh, shit. Yeah. The effects, I like the effects. What do you think about the effects? They looked a little cartoony, but I think that falls into the spirit of the original two movies.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, they could definitely change from when it actually comes out.
True. You
know, it's all special effects.
So true.
They can touch that shit up.
The thing that really stuck out to me is the time corridor when they're traveling through time in the phone booth. It was a nice homage to the original. Like, it was updated, but it was pretty much the same.
Yeah. Well, I think they're going to kind of... I'm going to use the term universe building lightly, but I think this movie is going to kind of imply that a lot of time has passed, you know, and, you know, everything in the movies is kind of acknowledged and happening. So there's, like, a canonical universe going forth. Whereas, you know, back then when the first two movies happened, no one saw movies like that, you know? Like, a sequel is just a sequel.
Right, yeah.
Time just picked up all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. There was just no idea of, like, books and comics and backstory and lore tabs.
True, and I think that's why it was a better time back then, because arcs were special back then. Like, when you had an arc in any format, it was something like, oh, shit, this is an ongoing story. Like, this is so important that it's an ongoing story and it's not just a bottle, like almost 99.9% of everything else is.
Yeah.
Now everything's an arc. Like, even the dumb shows that you wouldn't... Curb Your Enthusiasm is an arc now. Like, everything is. It doesn't matter what genre, what type of media. They went overboard with that, I think. And I hope that Bill and Ted doesn't try and fall in the trap of, oh no, we need to create a Bill and Ted universe and we're going to make 15 movies and a bunch of spinoffs.
Yeah, well, that was where I was going to eventually go, is because the whole daughters thing. I'm just like, oh God, please don't tell me they're trying to set up like Bill and Ted's daughters movie.
I mean, so this kind of goes back to the whole like can they do the comedy that they should be doing? Because I know you remember this part of Bogus Journey, and the original for that matter. The hot stepmom that started off dating, I think it started off with Ted originally, then went to Bill's dad, right? Or is it the other way around? Either way, this bitch was, she was the stepmom of one of them in the first movie. Then she switched sides and became the stepmom of the other one in the second movie. And all the humor around her were like really inappropriate sex jokes and like, I could see your tits, mom, and like shit like that. Do you think that they're going to do shit like that with the daughters now?
No way, dude.
Because, dude, if they did, that would just come out. That'd be like Muhammad Ali coming out with a right hook.
There's no fucking way that would happen.
I know.
John Reeves would be fucking canceled.
That's what I mean.
You're talking about the guy that does phantom hands around women when they're taking Hollywood pictures.
I forgot about that. Jesus Christ, you're right.
No touching.
Yeah. Well, let's just hope that the daughters aren't cringy. That's my only real hope with it. Don't make it some bullshit feminist cringe fest. Make them purposeful. Make them good characters. Write them well. Don't turn them into Mary Sues. And I'm good with it.
Most definitely. I have nothing to say.
I plead the fifth. All right. Finally, I would like to talk about the end of the trailer in which we see the jacked prison inmate versions of Bill and Ted serenading the real Bill and Ted with the perfect song or whatever. So like the whole premise of this movie is them going back in time to steal the perfect song from themselves. So in my opinion, what we're going to see is just like Excellent Adventure, but instead of going through different time periods and meeting different historical figures, they're going to meet different versions of themselves. And in this trailer, we see one of those, the jacked prison inmates. And again, I think going back to Keanu not falling out of character at all, his reaction to their song was perfect. He's like, a little dark, but that's cool. Like the way he did it, man, it was so genuine and awesome.
Yeah, well, I mean, Keanu Reeves is a pretty genuine dude. I think that's why Hollywood loves him.
Yeah.
Reeves beloved.
I don't think Hollywood loves him. I think his fans do. And I think Hollywood just goes along with it. I honestly think Hollywood doesn't like him very much. And I think that he's done this good despite that, not because of that. You know what I'm saying?
He hasn't did a little kids.
Yeah.
It's not on that theme list.
You're not going to see Keanu Reeves on the Lolita Express flight logs. That is for certain.
And that's where we go, folks.
And on that note, Broadcaster Nickels, do you give Bill and Ted Face the Music a thumbs up, a thumbs down, or the dreaded side thumb?
I will give it a thumb at 93 degrees.
That's a dreaded side thumb, goddammit. Don't you try and...
That's an upright thumb.
You goddamn bastard. You're trying to circumvent the system.
Unbelievable. These accusations.
Yeah. I'm going to give it a thumbs up. I didn't see anything that made me worry in the trailer. I didn't see anything that really stood out as just like, oh, this is going to be the shit either, though. It just seemed solid, and there was nothing that worried me. So I'm going to give it a cautious thumbs up. And with that...
Cautious thumbs up.
Are you ready for our review of Eurovision?
I have to take a shit.
And we're back with our review of David Dobkin's Eurovision. And the creators of this movie describe it as the following. When aspiring musicians Lars and Sigrid are given the opportunity to represent their country at the world's biggest song competition, they finally have a chance to prove that any dream worth having is a dream worth fighting for. Broadcaster Nickels, another Will Ferrell movie that isn't funny. Is that not bizarre to you?
I mean, I had little faith going into this movie, but this was better than What's a movie I can compare it? Sherlock. It was better than Sherlock Holmes.
Yeah, yeah. Will Ferrell tried to pivot into drama. It's a little weird. You remember the one where there was like a girl in his head? He was like a writer, and there was just some girl in his head who talked to him as he walked around? Or did you somehow skip that atrocity?
I skipped that atrocity. If I get a cringy feeling at all, I usually just avoid the content.
Yeah. He has made a soft pivot into drama, and the comedies that he does all seem to have like a little drama mixed in. And this one, Honey Dicks You, is a comedy, and it just ends up turning into a feel-good drama. It's a total Honey Dick.
Yeah, it's also a musical, which I really don't like.
Oh, God.
I hate fucking musicals.
So I guess this was made to appeal to the fans of both Will Ferrell and American Idol. Is that a big cross-section of humanity?
Or The Voice. I think it was like...
The Voice, whatever. You know what I'm saying. Song competition shows. They're all the same to me. How many
something like that.
How many fans of Anchorman are also fans of The Voice? I'm going to say that that cross-section isn't very big.
If you're asking that question, then you're out.
Yeah, so yeah, go into this movie. It's not a comedy. Everything you'll see about it leading into it, you'll think it's a comedy, and there are certainly some parts that are comedic and funny, but this is a drama, and Will Ferrell is the main credited writer of this movie. He wrote this movie, essentially, with one other guy, but he is the main guy, and he couldn't write himself a good character. His character is my least favorite in the movie. How about you?
Yeah, he's pretty lame. He's not likable. And he doesn't have that many good lines. And it, funny as it is, because, I mean, I don't have the highest things to say about this movie, but a lot of the other characters really outshine him, which makes him look even worse.
Yeah. It is a little sad when I think Rachel McAdams is a fucking mediocre actress that is a little overrated because she was in The Notebook and everyone fucking loves The Notebook. I don't think she's that great, but she outshined the fuck out of Will Ferrell in this movie.
No doubt.
And I liked Dan Stevens' character.
Is that Legion?
Yeah, that's the thing, though. Because I've seen Legion, I know what Dan Stevens is capable of. This movie was beneath him.
I don't know. I thought his character was pretty funny.
It was really funny, but the movie was still beneath him. I'll say both are true. He was probably one of the better parts of the movie. But
100%, there's no gay Russians.
Yeah. He had some of the best one-liners for comedy, for sure. But again, Rachel McAdams also has a few good ones too. Will Ferrell, I try and stretch my brain to think of his good, funny one-liners. And I turn up empty, you know, and we'll talk about some more stuff in the spoiler section. But overall, I'm just going to say that he is not memorable in this movie at all. And that is weird when he wrote the fucking thing.
Yeah, well, I mean, he could have wrote it for other people to shine more, you know.
I hope so.
And also, you know, we're in this age, you know, where you want the women to shine, you know, so... Might have been a calculated move, as you know, the Rock League aficionados would put it.
Yeah, and that's probably true because Rachel McAdams in this movie is probably one of the most likable female characters I've seen in recent memory. I'm not a fan of her. I'm not a fan of this movie, but the way they portray her in this movie is extremely likable. She's almost like the dream wife that you want, that you don't think exists, and then this doofus Will Ferrell has her, and he's just being this piece of shit and, you know, not cashing in on it. And they do a great job portraying that, at least.
Yeah, they do.
Pierce Brosnan. I fucking loved him in it. What did you think? Small but pivotal role. I thought
that was the only thing that kind of brought a smile to my face in this movie, to be honest. When I saw him, I was like, all right, this movie can be redeemed.
Yeah. So like some of the parts I laughed at the most involved him. And One of them wasn't really his line, but he was a part of it. And then like some of them were actually his lines.
Yeah. I mean, his role, I mean, his relationship with Will Ferrell's role kind of reminded me of, Walk Hard, the ballad of Dewey Cox.
You know, that's
where he's just like that. His father's always like the wrong kid dad. That's what that Pierce Brosnan reminds me of when he's telling his son that the Eurovision is stupid and he's wasting his life.
Yeah, definitely. Walk Hard was a great movie. Don't you miss good comedy movies? Like in the 2000s, comedy movies, there were like four good ones every year. Now I feel like we get one good one every 4 years. It sucks.
And they've aged so well. I go watch that movie. You'll laugh your fucking ass off.
Oh, hell yeah. Yep. This movie had some oddly dark humor, too. Did you notice that? Like, the way this is portrayed is like a family comedy movie that's just kind of lampooning, like, you know, kooky Icelandic voice contestants, reality TV stars. You know what I mean? And some of the humor, you're just like, damn, I don't even know, like, if kids should be allowed to watch this.
Yeah, I mean, what was the rating on that movie?
I don't really know, but despite what the rating is, when you look at the preview of that movie, you see the cover art, you kind of read the synopsis. What do you think? You think that's a family comedy, right?
I don't know. I mean, to be honest, what I really noticed in the movie is they did a lot of representation for the local people where they were filming, you know, where they were actually supposed to be and stuff. There's a lot of local actors, or at least of the same nationality that they were supposed to be in Iceland. They used, I think that town they filmed in was in Iceland.
It looked like Iceland. I've seen Iceland and it certainly looked like it.
I'm pretty sure Sigur Rós was some of the music for the OST of the film, which is a very famous Icelandic band. So, I mean, there's a lot of nods to it.
Overall, I would say this is a super dorky movie that isn't worth the time of an adult or a kid.
No.
And I don't know who this movie was made for, honestly. I really don't. That's the biggest impression I get and that I'll leave you with as we ready for our spoiler section. I just think that this movie didn't know what it wanted to be. It must have been like a love child of Will Ferrell that he used his star power to get made. I just don't understand why. I don't understand the inspiration. I don't understand the target audience. I don't understand its existence at all.
Yeah, it didn't even prop up any new actors.
No. So
it's not like he was giving his daughter a chance at a lead role or something like that.
Right, yeah. This wasn't like Will Smith and like Jaden Smith or whatever.
Take a knee. Oh, you haven't seen that movie, have you?
After Earth?
Yeah.
No, I never. Oh, God. Does he tell him to take a knee in After Earth?
It's the biggest meme of that movie.
Oh, my God. Maybe I need to watch that.
Will Smith over the comms is just like, take a knee. I told you, I said, take a knee.
And with that, let's go into our spoiler section, Broadcaster Nickels. Pierce Brosnan was one of the funniest characters, and he's like only on the screen like fucking 10 minutes, I feel like, but he has some of the most memorable funny parts, like the where the guy at the bar said that he was like the dad of half the children in the village, and like the way he just gives this little smirk and raises his beer glass in the air was fucking perfect, dude. It was almost like a reference to him being James Bond, Goldeneye, you know.
Yeah, pretty sure that's what it was.
I like the opening dream sequence right after they skip, because like the childhood thing in the very beginning, I thought that was really dumb. That whole scene, I think that was the worst scene in the movie. What do you think? When they're kids?
You know what? I barely remembered that. So yeah, I think it's not necessary.
Oh, dude, I remember just like, what is happening here? So he hears ABBA on the TV and he just jumps in front of the TV and starts dancing like a retard. And then like Rachel McAdams as a young girl apparently was a mute, and like Will Ferrell's childhood acting in front of the fucking TV is what inspired her to talk.
too. It's just like he helped her, you know, not become just start talking. It's just like, okay.
It was really fucking weird.
Also, dress the elephant in the room here. I never really touch on the subject that they're supposed to be brother and sister.
That was really weird. And I think that ties into the whole joke with Pierce Brosnan that I was just talking about, where he could be the dad of half the kids in the village. I think that's where the "I don't think she's my sister" thing comes from. I think that that's Will Ferrell dunking on his dad, implying that his dad might have banged Rachel McAdams' mom.
Well, he's definitely doing it now.
Oh, God, you're right. I didn't think of that. So the end, he does get with Rachel McAdams' mom, right?
Like they've been, you know, long lost loves for a while. See, that's what I'm getting at. I'm just like, man, this is kind of weird.
Holy shit. I didn't even realize that till you just brought it up. Okay, so holy shit. So we have just discovered that this ongoing joke is real. They really are. This is an incest movie. They're brother and sister.
They never denounce it.
Well, no. So, like, they make the joke the whole fucking movie.
A couple times they write it off with the phrase, "I don't think that's true."
Mm-hmm.
They say.
But then at the very end of the movie, literally, Pierce Brosnan gets with the mom, and, like, they're at the fucking show and, like, cheering them, and Will Ferrell's making jokes at him and shit. And this is when Will Ferrell and Rachel McAdams have a fucking baby.
They were singing at the wedding of them getting married. It was a wedding cake.
Holy shit. So,
damn. Spirit of Penguin, I need you to lower the volume of alcohol when watching these movies. This is detective work. I need you. Need you reliable.
I watched this movie 100% sober. I just didn't fucking. Wow. So, okay, yeah. So this is an incest movie. They make an incest baby at the end, and Pierce Brosnan starts banging Rachel McAdams' mom again, and it's a happy ending, and they start singing Ja Ja Ding Dong, the end. Okay. Damn. I don't even know where to go from there. I feel like we should go straight to the Joker rating.
All right. Demi Lovato. We gotta talk about Demi Lovato because she was a saving grace to this movie a little bit.
She was.
Because, dude, the first time out, she just got neglected. He's like, "Oh, fuck." He's like, "Get the fuck out of here." I died. And then she comes back towards the very end. She's just like, "Wait, Victor's gonna try to kill you." And he's like, "Yeah, I know. He already tried killing me, but the elf saved me. It's all right." And she's like, "Oh." She's like, "Get the fuck out of here." She's like, what did she say? She's like, God rest your soul," or some shit, just fades away.
Yeah, that whole thing was really funny. Back to the dark humor. When they blow up the ship with all the other contestants, that is like the MacGuffin that allows Will Ferrell and Rachel McAdams to go to this Eurovision contest in the first place. Demi Lovato's arm, her severed, gory arm, falls in front of them. And I think one of the funniest lines of the entire movie happens there, where just like on cue, Rachel McAdams is like, "The elves have gone too far this time."
Probably the best joke of the whole movie.
I think so.
The ones made about the elves.
Yeah, and Rachel McAdams, like, it's weird because you don't see her as a comedic actress, but she really nailed it in this movie. Even though this is not a great movie, she
definitely did a way better job than Will Ferrell. But Will Ferrell's been checked out for few years now, at least.
Yeah,
producing, to be honest. I'm surprised he still acts.
Yeah, I feel like he's getting ready for retirement. But going back to the dream sequence after the childhood thing, because we kind of, due to our revelation of this being a Game of Thrones incest story, we kind of lost track The dream sequence I kind of liked because it was like making fun of like retarded Swedish pop bands. That's like a thing in those Northern European countries. They do these super corny music videos, and like they have Will Ferrell and Rachel McAdams like playing keyboards in the middle of a fjord with Viking armor on and shit. What I found interesting is that the song that they played in that sequence is never uttered again the rest of the movie.
Yeah, well, that wasn't the song that they play at the end of Eurovision that breaks the rules?
No, that's the little solo song that she was designing by herself.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
you're right.
Yeah, so the song in this intro sequence, it's literally one and done in a musical, but the ongoing meme of the elves was pretty funny. I think, like, if you're going to talk about, like, what was the funniest arc of the movie, it was the elves arc. I mean, we talked about the arm falling and, you know, Rachel McAdams saying the elves went too far this time. My other favorite part about it is when the villain shows himself, who is the central banker. Like, it was really on the nose, like, this global banking cartel kingpin. And
I'm the one that blew up the boat.
The whole villain reveal, and I just love the way that the elf door just opens and just throws a knife and assassinates him. It was just the elves were used really well. I think if you're going to talk like of a comedic strand within a movie, that was the good part.
That was the only truly good comedy in that movie.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I liked Dan Stevens as the gay Russian lounge singer, but ultimately, the whole point of him wanting to steal Rachel McAdams to further his own career was stupid. It made no sense logically. I get that she's like a dream waifu and she has the voice of an angel and all that, but him courting her and like trying to pretend like he's sexually interested in her while using her talents, there is no feasibility in that plan. It was like something out of Pink Panther.
Yeah, it didn't really make sense to me either. As a plot hole for sure. The only thing I could think is that they were trying to like insinuate that she was like vulnerable and that he could detect that's what she wanted most, and that was his way in.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, so you kind of hit on the fact that this is a kind of a pseudo musical. They kind of honey dick you, and this is not the movie you think it is, and it's not any more apparent than in the scene at Dan Stevens' mansion party.
I got so disinterested when I saw that happen. I was like, fuck, how much more time is this movie?
This shit reminded me of like a celebrity Zoom call. Like, you know, the cringy shit you've been seeing lately with these celebrities doing Zoom calls and trying to do cute little things. That's literally what this scene looked like.
Rest in pepperonis, Aaron Paul.
Yeah, it was atrocious. It was epically cringe. Not good. That I honestly, I wanted to turn the movie off when I got to that scene, but I persisted. And at least we were rewarded with the hamster wheel scene.
I honestly thought Rachel McAdams was going to die.
That would have made the movie a lot better.
That would have been a dark horse turn right there.
Yeah. But I wasn't buying the everyone is going to vote for Iceland now after that shit. Like that whole thing, like the miracle. Oh, they're voting for us. Did you buy that at all?
I mean, the whole fucking industry, it seemed super cringe. So it didn't surprise me that they went max cringe. You know, like, I mean,
yeah. Yeah.
That's just how I see it. They like really fucking stupid shit. What is Eurovision? Ridiculous.
What did you think about the American tourist arc?
That was pretty funny, honestly. That was the only good Will Ferrell joke he had, how consistently he hated Americans. He had very specific jokes.
I didn't like it as much as you. I thought it was pretty annoying. I really didn't like it when, at the end, he meets them again, and they just decide to give him a ride to this fucking contest. Like, this whole sequence was just unbelievable. Like, you're going to let this weird, sweaty Icelandic guy hijack your car and force it. He carjacks them, basically. It's so fucking weird.
He does it in a polite way, though. He does it in the European way. Yeah. Not like some savage American would.
Yeah. Yeah, I think my favorite part with the American tourist was actually the very, very end at the wedding, where we apparently find out that they're actually brother and sister and it's an incest love story.
Can't get over that one?
No. I think that's the most prolific part about this movie, and I didn't even realize it until we started talking about it.
I don't know how Rachel McAdams and Will Ferrell, you know, well, I guess Will Ferrell wrote it, but I don't know how any of the other actors read the script and they're like, huh, okay. Okay, I'm in.
Yeah. So the part where the Americans were at that wedding and like he's like, no, really, we want you to leave now. We fucking hate you. It reminded me of kind of like a Sacha Baron Cohen type thing.
Yeah. I don't want him to give that guy any credit anymore.
Yeah.
Fuck that guy. Here at the Crack Cellar, we do not approve of Sacha Baron Cohen. Not good.
So, this movie, in general, just kind of sucked, right? Like, you go into this movie, and it's like, oh, this is a Will Ferrell comedy movie. And instantly you think of Anchorman, or Step Brothers, or even the other guys, if you want to take something kind of newer. He has been in good movies, and he has led good movies with some seriously good comedic performances. This ain't it.
Yeah, well, I mean, again, like I said earlier, he's just not in it anymore, and I think it has a lot to do with just the age of comedy. I think Will Ferrell really physically shows how scared he is to be funny in his own way. Because all of his comedy is kind of like dead comedy. You can't do it anymore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so he's just a really good example of how you cripple people's talent by making it offensive. Makes movies like Eurovision.
On that note, Broadcaster Nickels, what is your hit?
Elves.
Yeah, the Elves were fucking awesome.
I mean, all they did was drink whiskey and take some people out when they needed to.
The earnestness of her delivery when she talks about these elves is so endearing. And I think that's what sets it up to be so awesome when you just see them throw like a tactical knife out their door and murder this guy.
I fucking died.
I wish the whole movie could have channeled that spirit, because we would have had a good movie on our hands. But my hit is the Jar Jar Ding Dong. So there are two scenes with this, and they're both bar scenes in Iceland. And they're like, we want to play for you our version of a song that we're going to do, you know, on our contest. And they're like, fuck you, no, Jar Jar Ding Dong. And they're like, we've already played Jar Jar Ding Dong. And they're like, fuck you, play Jar Jar Ding Dong again. Like, that guy, the guy who pushed Jar Jar Ding Dong, like, that was one of my favorite parts of the movie, too. Like, him and Pierce Brosnan and the elves probably are my trinity in this movie.
He was pretty good. He was the only one with real emotion in this movie.
Yeah, and in the first one, he follows them, like, they like take a break because they're, like, sick of Jar Jar Ding Dong, and they're, like, outside discussing things. And this dude fucking follows them outside. He just starts yelling, do a Jar Jar Ding Dong again. I don't know what it is about this guy, but he cracked me the fuck up.
We're done. Fuck no. All right, we're on break. We'll be back in a minute.
Oh, shit. But that being said, Broadcaster Nickels, what is your miss?
I would have to say Will Ferrell himself. Just boned it in. Nothing seemed like he didn't need to actually be there. He could have had someone else act that role, you know? Like, it's just, I think he thought he had to do it because people wouldn't watch it if they didn't see Will Ferrell, you know? Which might be true. But nonetheless, it's just, I don't know. You could just tell that he wasn't meant for that role, nor did he really want to play that role. That's my opinion.
I agree. And I think everything you just said is 100% spot on. I don't think Will Ferrell wanted to be in this movie. I think he showed up in this movie to help the other people in it. I think you're also right that he wrote this movie for other people. There's no other reason for him to write himself so poorly in this movie other than to detract from himself and promote the other people. I don't think that was the right choice, but I think that's what he was going for. My miss was The American Tourist. I really thought, like, especially the first scene where, like, Will Ferrell's big comeback was, why don't you go to Starbucks? I was cringing so hard. It's just like, why don't you go back to America and build your wall? I was just like, dude, it didn't really make the Americans look bad. It made Will Ferrell and Europeans look bad.
I don't know where he was really coming from either, because he's an American making fun of his own culture and playing a European and looking like an idiot.
Mm-hmm. There's so many angles to that. Like, you just hit on like four of them, but there's probably five more. Like, it's just such a weird rabbit hole, like with this whole character with Will Ferrell. And I just thought, like, the American Tourist thing overall, I thought it was a big miss. If you're going to make fun of Americans, you could do it in way better, more creative ways. And you could actually write it realistically instead of like the whole, oh, it's the crazy European guy that like harassed us earlier. Let's break all of our plans. We're going the opposite direction. Let's break all these plans and take this guy to this weird Eurovision contest. Hell no, dude. If this were real life, those people would have thought Will Ferrell was a murderer and he was going to lead them to a hostel in Czechoslovakia. This is bullshit. I call bullshit on the American Tourist arc, and that is my miss. That being said, Broadcaster Nickels, what is your whiff?
I think it would probably be Dan Stevens. Yeah, I mean, he was pretty cool, but he, like you said earlier in the podcast, he could have been utilized a little bit more. The whole idea of him positioning himself as trying to fill in as the significant lover instead of Will Ferrell in Rachel McAdams' life is like to, you know, wound her over. Just didn't really make sense because he was clearly gay. And they tell you that like right at the critical part where you're like wondering if what's going to happen, you know, the cliffhanger moment. And they're just like, oh, he's gay. And it's just like they just defuse it immediately. It's like, so what the fuck? You think they would have saved that for after the moment, like right when Rachel McAdams would fall for him and then Will Ferrell would be like, no. And then he'd be like, well, actually, I'm gay or something. Or it would be. Well, it would just be something like that. The way they did it was just like, okay, what now? That just totally like kills the villain's agenda. Like, he just wanted to win the contest that he's already won.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree.
That was really good. That's why he's the whiff. You know, he's a really good actor and he played the character well, but it just seemed like the agenda wasn't there.
Yeah, it was beneath him. I don't know, like, did he do this because he was doing a favor, or did he do this because he thought it was going to further his career? Because if it's the latter, he needs to get a new advisor, a new agent, a new management company, a new everything, because there's no way this movie is going to help his career. What a crappy title, by the way. You couldn't come up with anything better than that.
I think they were planning on banking on this, just the fans of the actual Eurovision contest. Isn't that a thing?
Maybe. I've never heard of it. I'm not from Europe. I'm guessing it is a thing. I'm guessing it's their version of American Idol.
Yeah, I thought that's what they were doing, to be honest.
In fact, I wouldn't even be surprised if this movie was based off of a real Eurovision, if Eurovision is real. I would not be surprised if this was based on a real Eurovision contestant, because there's something really odd about this movie where it doesn't feel like it should exist.
That'd be fucking terrible if this is based on a real story. The incest part became so much more real.
Oh shit, yeah, the incest storyline really takes a dark turn if this is based on a true story. Shit.
No.
Well, this is all conjecture, and I really pray now that it is not based on a real story. That being said, my whiff is the ending of this movie.
Explain.
Why in the hell did you do this, Will Ferrell? You can joke about the incest all you want, and it was fine. You joked about it like 9 times in this movie, and it was cute and blah, blah, blah. But then in the end, you end up with Rachel McAdams. So it should have remained a joke. But instead, you confirm it's real. What the fuck? And on that note, Broadcaster Nickels, as you know, here on the Crack Cellar, we use the official Joker rating system. On that system, what do you rate Eurovision?
You know, I added Jared Leto recently. He did not respond.
Powerful.
That being said, I'm going to have to give him one gangster joker known as Jared Leto.
Well deserved. I am also going to give this movie a Jared Leto. This is an abomination. It is something that should have been buried 6 feet under the porch. It should have never come to life. And even if it was buried in the pet cemetery, it will not rise again.
Sometimes not writing a story is better.
And on that note, we will close out. I am the liquor man.